Well, hello everyone. Good morning and good afternoon and good evening, no matter where you are. I know we have people from countries all over the world joining us today. So thank you for being here. I really appreciate you taking the time to jump on this webinar and spend some time with us today. We've got a very important topic and we're talking about productivity today. And I would be remiss if I talked about productivity and did a productivity session or a productivity webinar for a very, very, very long time. That would not be very productive use of your time on this Thursday. So my goal is to keep this short, keep it sweet, and get right to the point. I want to get right to the point. The last thing you need is something that's just adding more noise to a very noisy world. We want to make this practical and helpful and get you started on your productivity journey for you personally and for others as well. So the title of today's webinar is Mastering Productivity, the Intentional Practice of Being Productive in a Busy World. That subtitle is incredibly important. And the word that's most important there is intentional. And I want you to think about that. You will never naturally trend towards productivity. We will naturally trend towards apathy. We will naturally trend towards not doing the things that we're supposed to do. We will naturally trend towards things that are easy to do. We will not naturally trend towards things that are hard and difficult to do. So we have to be intentional to be productive and to get there and to be productive in a world that is so busy. How many times do you meet someone or you meet a friend or a family member or someone new and you say, you know, how are things going? How are you doing? Oh, I've been so busy. Everyone's busy. And so we want to remove that word busy from your vocabulary and replace it with being productive. So we're going to talk about that today. So a lot of you may be thinking, you signed up for this webinar today, and you think, well, I already know how to be productive. I've done this before. I know all the tips and tricks. I use a planner. I have a planner. I use my phone calendar. I've got different AI tools that help me with my scheduling. I've got a virtual assistant, all these different things. You say, I know how to be productive. Well, one of my favorite quotes is from Confucius, saying it's to know and to not do is to not yet know. So just because we can know, we think we know all these things, and I'm speaking to myself as well. Just because we think we know something, if we're not actively doing that thing, then we don't actually know it. And so just because we have all this knowledge and we've read all these books on productivity and articles and attended webinars like this and used planners and different things, just because we have these tools and we've used these things and attended these things does not mean we truly know how to be productive. And I also want to make it very clear, I am not some productivity expert that's any better than anyone else. I come to you from a place of humility saying, this is something I am putting my hand up and saying, I'm trying to get better at this as well. And so in trying to improve in this, by putting this presentation together, I've discovered tips and tricks and different things that I'm implementing in my life now. So I'm on this journey with you. This isn't someone talking down to someone here. We're all on the same level here. We're all trying to be more productive. And I come to you from a place of, let's all do this together. We're working on this together. Let's implement some processes that have been proven time after time, year after year, country after country, culture after culture, and really impact our schedules and our time. So if to know and to not yet and to not do is to not yet know, then how can we know? Well, there's a couple of things I do know. The world is not very productive. With so much technology and so many tools coming out, the buzzword now is, of course, AI. It'll be something else in about 5 or 10 years from now. But there's so many things that are supposed to make us more productive, right? Well, in reality, the opposite has happened. The world has actually gone from an annual productivity growth of 3% to less than 1% over the past decade. So in the rise of technology, we've seen a decrease in productivity. Right? And that's with more productivity tools than ever before. In the first half of 2022, productivity plunged by the sharpest rate since 1947. And that's not just a statistic I made up. That's from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. All right. So they know what they're talking about. It plunged by the most since 1947. Okay. They did not have AI tools, not many back in 1947. Okay. Every employee is interrupted on average, this is just the average, of once per 3 minutes. So let's say we're meeting for 30 minutes today. There's a strong possibility you'll be interrupted at least 10 times. Your phone's going to go off. Your watch is going to, you know, ding you or tap you. Someone's going to come into your office. You're going to hear something from another room. A little pop-up's going to come up on your computer screen or something. Something's going to happen. The average person spends less than 3 hours per day on high payoff activities. That's the average. So that's in the middle. So there's way worse. There is better, but there's way worse. And that's the average person. So if the average person in your organization is interrupted once every 3 minutes, has a productivity, the biggest productivity plunge since 1947, and they're only working on average 3 hours per day on what they're actually supposed to be doing, how is there any way that we're actually getting done what we need to get done? There's just no way. So another comeback to that some people have tried to implement is, well, we just need to work harder. We've got to work harder. We've got to do more work, more hours. We got to do more and more and more. Well, one of my favorite books that I read is a book called Great at Work by Morton Hansen, who's a professor, I believe, at UCLA here in the United States. And he did this massive study on what makes people great at work and what makes people just okay at work. And what he found that is beyond 50 hours of work in a week, productivity benefits sharply start to decline. So the humans cannot work effectively more than around 50 hours per week. Now, there are times when you have to. There's a huge project coming up, and there are times you're going to only work 20, 30 hours a week. You've got a big break or something like that. Not a lot comes up, and there's different things like that that can happen. But on average, again, we're talking about averages here. The average individual cannot work more than 50 hours a week and be productive. So the answer is not more work. The answer is not doing more and using more time. So what's the answer? So if the world, we can all agree, has a productivity problem, we cannot say that just increasing the hours of work will fix the problem. It will not fix the problem. We can't just work more and more and more. That's how you have people working 80-hour weeks. I spoke with a friend recently who worked back-to-back 100-hour weeks. And of course, he was burnt out. He was having trouble at home. He wasn't sleeping. He was on drinking so much coffee, full of caffeine all the time, just trying to stay awake to get all this work done. Naturally, he was not being very productive. He felt like he wasn't getting things done. He felt panicked. That's what happens when we work 80, 100 hour weeks. So that is not the solution to the problem. And so if we want to fix the world, right, we want to change the world. That's hopefully everyone on this call, you have some deeper thing that you're trying to do through your career. And so you want to change the world, and the world has a productivity problem. So we want to help solve that productivity problem. Well, if we want to change the world and fix the productivity problem so we can then fix other problems in the world, the first thing we need to do is draw a circle around ourselves and change everything that's inside of it first. And so instead of looking at other people and saying, how can I improve productivity on my team? There's people that are not working hard enough. They're not doing what they need to do and all these kinds of things. We need to look internally first and say, what am I not doing? How can I change myself and become more productive? So the first thing you've got to do is draw a circle around yourself and change what is inside of it. And that's what we're going to talk about today. We're not worried about what other people are doing. We've got a lot of time for that. Everyone wants to talk about what employees are doing and Gen Z is doing and the boomer generation. What are they doing? Millennials, where are they at in all this? No. Forget about all that for right now. We're looking at you. We're looking at you and I'm looking at myself. What can we personally do to become more productive? And if you remember, a lot of parenting books say that things are caught, not taught. And so if that does not translate well from English to another language, what that means is what you see someone do is way more impactful than them just telling you what to do. So if you see someone be productive, there's a higher likelihood of them actually being productive as well than you just telling people how to be productive. So we want to lead by example. And the way to lead by example is by actually implementing what we're going to talk about today. And so we have a thing at the organization I represent called Leadership Management International called the Total Leader Concept. And we believe that everyone can become a total leader. However, at the foundational element of leadership is time management. And so everyone wants to lead others. We want to change the world, but you first have to lead yourself. We just talked about that. Well, to lead yourself, you have to manage your time effectively. All of us have been given 24 hours per day, right? We've all been given 24 hours per day. Everyone has that. No matter where you are, no matter where you come from, you have 24 hours per day. How you manage those 24 hours is the first and most important step in your leadership journey. And that is, no matter who you are, where you are, what level you're at in your career, whether you're a student, whether you're retired, or anywhere in between, what you do with your 24 hours is the most important leadership quality about you. So if we don't master our time, if we don't master our productivity, there's no way we can lead ourselves, and there's no way we can lead others. That's why this is such an important topic. So I want you to picture something. Now we're going to start diving into the actual how. Well, how do we do this, right? Clearly, there's a problem. Clearly, we want to solve it. Well, what do we do? How do we do this? Well, first, I want you to picture something. I want you to imagine something. This is one of my favorite metaphors that I use. I want you to imagine that your life is a house. And so my wife and I built a house a couple of years ago. When we met with our builder, and I met with the builder, and my wife and I were speaking with the builder didn't sit there and say, okay, here's all the tools we're going to use for your house. I want you to look at all these tools. What do you think we should use? What tools should we use to build this house? That's not what they did. What they said is, I want you to envision the house that you want to build and draw it. Write out the descriptions. Bring inspiration pictures. What do you want it to look like? What do you want it to feel like when you walk in? What do you want to see with your eyes when you walk through the door? What do you want your children's bedrooms to look like eventually? What do you want the yard to look like? Where do you want a tree? Where do you want the shade to be? You get this clear vision of where we're going to live. Well, that's what we need to do with our lives as well. If all we do is focus on the tools that help us build the house, that help us build our life, and we have no clear picture of what our life should be, then the tools aren't going to do anything. We need to focus way more on the builder than we do the tools. And the builder of your house is you. The builder of your life is you. And so by just focusing on productivity tools and how we can be more productive by using this AI tool or that tool or this planner or that planner, which one's better and all those things, you can have the best tools in the world, but given to the wrong individual, the house is just not going to look great. When we met with our builder to build a house, if the builder said, look at these tools, we just purchased these are the best tools in the entire world. Now, Jonah, I want you to go build your house. Let me tell you right now, we would not be living in that house. That house would be on the ground. The slightest wind gust would have knocked it over if I ever even got it off the ground. I have no idea how to use those tools because I'm not a good builder. I don't know how to build a house. And so I would have to learn how to be a good builder before I'm given these good tools to do it, right? Well, the same thing is true. You can give a really good builder really bad tools, and they can build an amazing house. You all probably know, maybe your grandfather or your father or someone you know who's really good with their hands, and they fix cars or they build things or whatever. A lot of them are probably using tools that they used back in the 70s and 80s, and they just never got rid of them. You want to buy them new tools and say, no, what I've got is good. I don't need that. Well, maybe they would benefit from some better tools. We all can agree on that. However, they're so good at what they do, they know their tools and they know them well, and they're going to use their tools and they're going to be a master of those tools and build something beautiful. And so we don't want to focus on just the tools. We want to focus on the builder. And this is something that I want you to take away. So if you haven't remembered anything yet, this is something to remember. This is something to screenshot, right? Take a screenshot of this right here. No matter how great the tool, the house can only be constructed within the confines of the expertise of the builder. And that's what we're talking about right now. You can have the best productivity tools in the entire world, but if you don't personally unjumble your thoughts and get your brain thinking the right way about how to be productive, what's important? What's important to you? What do you need to do today? What is imperative today? What's the most important thing? What's your highest payoff activity? The tool's not going to do anything for you. It's just going to make you more and more busy, and your schedule's going to look really pretty as it's filled with things that don't matter. We're not here to make pretty schedules. We're here to make a really big impact on others and in our lives as well. So no matter how great the tool, the house can only be constructed within the confines of the expertise of the builder. So we want to focus on improving the builder, and that's you and that's me, and that's what we're talking about. So what is the difference between productivity and busyness? We've touched on this a little bit. I want to dive into it a little more. Like I said earlier at the very beginning, you'll go and talk with someone and they'll say, oh, I'm just so busy right now. but they feel like they're not getting anything done. You know, they're dropping their kids off at this place, and then they've got this meeting with the club that they're a part of, and then they've got this these calls they've got to make for their sales job, and then they've got to work on the taxes they've got to pay, and then they've got to do their finances for their home and all these different things and blah, 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 blah. There's all these things. It's kind of like a saying we say, it's like running around with a chicken with its head cut off, right? So you just run around, you've got no idea where you're going, you're running into walls, and it's just crazy. Yeah, you're really busy, but you're not going anywhere. You're not actually doing anything. You're just running around. And you're going to be really tired. If you run in a circle really, really fast for a long time, you're going to be really, really tired by the end of that. But if you run from point A to point B, you're still going to be really tired, but you're going to get somewhere. And you're going to get a lot further than you did by just running around in a circle with no direction. So the difference between productivity and busyness is just having a full schedule. We can all have a full schedule. Productivity is producing the highest amount of ROI per activity, return on investment. Productivity is actively measuring the return on investment per activity that you're doing. So what is the output from all of the activities you're doing? That's what productivity is, not just having a full schedule. So a few questions for you. And if you don't know these answers off the top of your head, then we've all got things to do. We've all got things to improve. And again, as I was preparing this, right, I had to answer these questions myself. I had to go back to this. I have to do this almost on a weekly basis to just go back to, okay, what's most important? My wife and I are expecting our second child right now. Things are getting busier. So how do I stay productive in all areas of my life? I got to come back to these questions. What is the actual value of your time? How much money do you make per year? Whether it's hourly or whether it's a salary with commissions or whatever it is, you should know exactly how much you're planning on making this year. Then you should know how much you make per month, how much you make per week. You should have the all the way down to how much you make per hour and way down to how much you make per minute. You need to know that number. That has to be a number that you can just say at an instant. How much money do you make per minute? And it's not all about money. And we'll get into that in a second, but this is a really easy way to check this, right? What are your highest payoff activities? What are your highest payoff activities? Now, what is a high payoff activity? That means that, let's say something takes 10 minutes, right? And let's say, just for the sake of easy math, I'm no mathematician over here. Let's say your value of your time is $1 per minute, right? And you do something for 10 minutes, then it costs you $10 to do that thing. Is that thing that took you 10 minutes worth $10 or more? If yes, then it's potentially a high payoff activity. If it's only worth about $5 or less than $10, it's a low payoff activity because it's costing you more than what you're doing, right? So you have to know, what are your high payoff activities? What are you doing? What's the output that's coming from the input of your time, right? And so this is going to change. This is different for everyone. And again, I'm going to get to personal things as well. And we'll get to that in a second. But you need to know, what are all of the activities that you do? You got to rank them from highest to lowest. You need to know how much money it's costing you via your time. You have to know how much it's costing you and how much that output is giving you. Is your schedule only full of the highest payoff activities, or is it full of a bunch of low payoff activities as well? And I know what you may be thinking, I've got to get these other things done. They're not super high payoff, but I've got to get them done. Well, we're going to get to that as well. Just because something needs to be done doesn't mean that you need to be the person that does it. And it also doesn't mean that it needs to get done right now. And sometimes there are some kind of low payoff things that do need to get done right now. Yes, that happens. But if they're scheduled, you can still make sure that your highest payoff activities are scheduled. And so what about your personal life? What are your highest payoff activities in your personal life? And you say, you know, highest payoff activities, the money that my time is worth and those kinds of things. Well, start thinking about that from a personal side as well. Maybe you're so caught up in your work that the last time you had a date night with your spouse was months ago, and you really need to do that. And you really value that time with your spouse. I know I'm there with one child and a second on the way and working a lot and all these things. Time with my spouse away, that is a high payoff activity. That is really high payoff. I look at the money that it's going to cost from going out to dinner and the time it takes her and I to be away and not working on other things. And I can absolutely say without a shadow of a doubt that that is a high payoff activity. What comes out of that is far superior than the money, the time it's taking to invest in that. Time with your kids, what about that, right? What about if you like to golf or you like to cycle or you like to work out at the gym or read or watch movies or all these different things? None of these things are bad things, right? These things can all be high payoff activities in their right place, but they've got to be scheduled, and we've got to schedule them based on their how high payoff they are. So I want you to think about all areas of your life here. At LMI, we have a thing called the total person concept, which is that we separate all of our lives into six quadrants. We make the wheel of life. You may have seen this before. We have your financial and career, mental and educational, social and cultural, physical and health, spiritual and ethical, family and home. There's all these different areas. So imagine this is like you're riding a bike and this is your tire. This is your wheel. Imagine if everything's going really well, but your family and home is much worse than the other five, and the spokes of that tire are much shorter than the other ones. How do you think that bike ride is going to go? It's going to be incredibly bumpy. You're not going to get very far, and it's not going to be very comfortable, and it's going to be a lot harder to get somewhere than it needs to be if everything was balanced. So again, productivity doesn't just mean pouring everything into that top quadrant of financial and career. That's not all it's about. It's about making sure that everything we're doing in our financial and career is high payoff so that we can work not 100 hours, we can work a normal amount of hours and get a ton of really valuable high payoff work done, and then have time for all of these five other quadrants as well. We can spend time with our families. We can work on spiritual and ethical health and physical health and social health and go meet with people and friends and invest in our communities and mental and educational stimulation through reading or discussions with people and all these kinds of things. We have to be productive. And it's kind of like, I want you to think about bowling for a second. I don't know if you bowl, if everywhere has bowling alleys, I don't know. But when you go bowling, especially if you're not very good, there's a thing on each side called the gutters. And if you don't bowl it straight down the lane, the ball will go into the gutters, right? And let's say you're really, really bad, and all you do is bowl gutter balls the whole time. You have a score of zero at the end. Well, that's not very fun. That's just not very enjoyable. Well, they have a thing called bumpers that they can put up. And that's where these little walls come up. And no matter how bad you throw the ball, it'll bounce off the bumpers and still hit some pins at the end. This is extremely popular with children or with people like myself who are really bad at bowling and just want to hit some pins and have a good time. Well, in our lives, our schedule and how we budget our time is like these bumpers, right? We can say, no, I'm just going to keep throwing the ball down the lane. I'm never going to get any better. And we just keep getting gutter balls. Well, we need to put up some parameters, some barriers that keep us focused on what we're supposed to do so that when we throw a ball, when we use our time and we're going down the alley of life, that we have bumpers that are keeping us on this alley. It's keeping us going forward towards what really matters, when we're hitting pins every time and we're being productive, not just busy. So what bumpers do you need to put up in your life to make sure that you are only doing things that are knocking down pins, that are only producing results? And again, when I say words like results and high payoff and ROI, return on investment, and all those kinds of things, I'm not just talking about your career and sales and bottom line revenue. I'm talking about everything. What are the results you want to see in your physical health and your mental health and all these kinds of things? You've got to put up these barriers and schedule your time based on your highest payoff activity so that you have the freedom to do everything you need to do to live a balanced life and achieve results in all of these areas. And so your priorities matter. And so I have a question now. After this quote, I do have a question. This isn't a song. This is a song lyric, but I think it's incredibly valuable. So if love had a currency, or if love was a thing, time would be its currency, right? So time is love's currency of choice. So if you love someone, you're going to spend a lot of time with them. That's kind of how you show them that you love them, is by the time you spend with them. If you love something, you're going to probably spend a lot of time doing it. If you love reading, you're probably going to spend a lot of time reading. If you love your spouse, you'll probably spend a lot of time with them. If you love your company, you'll probably spend a lot of time working. That's just a basic thing, that whatever we love, we'll probably spend more time doing. And priorities, really what that means is the things you love the most, things you really want to do, things you care about doing, especially at this time in your life. And again, priorities change over time. My kids were not a huge priority before I had kids. Now I have a little one that's, you know, 13 months, and I've got a second one on the way. So my priorities have completely switched, right? And my kids are way up there now. And then, you know, maybe you're on the end of your career and your career is not as high of a priority as it is to someone who's in their 30s and 40s and 50s, right? It's just different for everyone. Maybe you're a student and your studies are incredibly important right now, or you're getting your master's or your PhD or something. And that's a huge thing right now, but eventually your educational is going to come down a little bit and your career is going to go up. Your family's going to go up more. So our priorities change, but you have to know what your priorities are. And we all have an idea of what our priorities are. And so I have a challenge for you. And this is where the question comes in. If something is your highest priority, it should use the majority of your time. And this is an incredibly sobering thought for myself, and I hope it is for you as well. So let's say I put physical as the number one priority. Oh yeah, that is what I need to do 100%. That's the thing I care about the most. I'm super focused on my physical health. And then I go and I look at my schedule and my time and how I use my time. Remember, time is love's currency of choice. And there's no exercise on there. I'm never going to the gym. I'm never running. I'm never riding a bike. I'm never going for walks, nothing. Then I can say that that's my priority all I want, but it's just factually not. And we're kidding ourselves. So let's say, again, let's say it's family. And I say, oh, my spouse, number one, no doubt. And I haven't taken her on a date night in 5 years. There's just no way. I'm not spending time with her. There's no way that she is actually my priority. It's just not possible. And so we can say, let's bring it to our work life, right? Let's say that my highest priority when I'm working is to make sales calls because I'm in a sales job. I need to make sales calls. Well, if you look at your schedule, and you're spending more time scrolling social media than you are on calls, then actually your number one priority is scrolling social media, not making sales calls. It's just a factual, it's just a very factual thing. The thing you spend the most time doing is the thing that's your highest priority. So you need to make a list of those six areas of life. What do you think your priority is there? And then what does your schedule tell you that your priorities are? And what's the difference? And what is that gap? And I would encourage you to do that today. It can be an incredibly sobering thing. It can be a humbling thing, but it's an incredibly important exercise to do. And when we know what we want our priorities to be, we can start scheduling our time to look more like those priorities. And so does your schedule reflect your stated priorities? And that's the question I want to leave you with when you do that exercise, right? But how do you know if your activities are actually taking you where you want to go? So let's say you are being productive and you're taking time out of your day. You say, okay, I've done this exercise. I know the value of my time. I know what I need to do. I need to know how much I need to be doing it and all these things. And I need to do this much time with my kids, and I'm going to spend this much time on my physical health, this much time on my mental health and all these things. How do you know that you're actually even going where you want to go? You have to have an end in mind. You have to have a destination. Again, if I hop in a car and I start driving as fast as I can in a direction, but I don't know where I'm going, how do I know that I'm actually going the right way? I could say, I am making so much progress right now. Look at how fast I'm going. But if I don't know what my end destination is, I can actually look back at where I was supposed to be going, and I could have gone the entirely different direction than where I wanted to go. That's not productive. Just because I'm going fast and doing a lot of things and making a lot of progress in a direction does not mean I'm making progress in the direction I should have been making progress. And so it's not productive just to get things done. So high payoff does not just mean the highest financial return, period. That's not what it means. It's the highest return to you. And this comes down to your personal goals. What is personally motivating to you? Not what does your company say is motivating. So not what is your company's bottom line revenue goal. Not what do you think the world is saying your goals need to be for how you spend your time. What is actually meaningful to you? What do you actually want to accomplish in your life? What do you actually want to do? What do you actually want to see a return in? The highest payoff activities are not just going to be the things that say, okay, it costs me this much and it produces this much. Okay, that's my highest payoff activity. No, no, no. That's the start. Then you take that and you say, okay, now what matters the most to me? So I may be losing money when I go on a date night with my spouse, right? Because we're spending our money, right? We both are working and we're bringing in money and we're spending. Well, but the value that comes out of that, the closeness we feel to each other, oh my gosh, that is so far superior than the dollars and cents I'm paying to do that. And we're paying to do that, right? So highest payoff means highest return to you. And you have to know where your destination is to know what's high payoff to you personally. And so let's rewind. At the very beginning, we started with this quote, to know and to not do is to not yet know. So what do you do then? You have to know where you're going and you have to know what you're going to do. So first you need to identify the value of your time. You have to know, how much is my time worth? That's what we talked about previously. Then you need to identify, what is every single activity in your life, in all areas of life? Get them all down on paper. What is everything that you do? Then you assign time to your highest payoff activities, right? You say, okay, based on my goals, based on what I'm doing, based on what I want to do and where I want to go, what are the activities that are going to get me there the fastest? When I'm at work, when I'm working, what are the things I need to be doing to help me hit my goal as quick as possible? When I'm meeting, when I'm with my family, what are the goals that I'm working on to get our family to? What are the things I want to do with my family? Okay, I need to make those my highest payoff activities when I'm home with my family. When I'm reading, I'm working on my mental health, or taking a break working on my mental health or something like that. What is going to get me closest to my ideal place where I'm learning things and relaxing and those kinds of things? Schedule it out. Then you need to eliminate or delegate all other activities. So if it's not a high payoff activity and it does not need to be done right now, then that simply means it does not need to be done. We all need to take a big, deep breath and exhale and just admit that we can't do everything. We are not superheroes. We cannot do everything. Humans were not created to get everything done every single day. It's just not possible. It is not sustainable and is not healthy. So simply trying to cram your calendar full of more and more and more and more and more is not going to work. You're not benefiting yourself. You're not benefiting others, and you're not benefiting your organization or the world around you. No one's going to benefit from that. You will have busier times in your life than others, but in those busy times and in those times when things are crazy and hectic, we have to be more and more in tune with what our schedule actually says, where we're actually going, what our goals actually are, and where we want to go. And we have to assign time intentionally. Remember that word at the very beginning, the intentional assigning of time to our highest payoff activities. Like, if something doesn't get done today, but we got all of our high payoff activities done today, our highest ones, then we can go to bed that night saying we did a good job in all areas of life. So that's what I want to encourage you with, is one, you don't need to do everything. Two, there are other people that are probably really good at things that you're not good at. I am not a super data-driven person. That's not something that I'm really good at usually. I've gotten better and I've worked on improving that skill, but it's a lot easier for me to have someone sit down with me and look at a spreadsheet and help explain what that means than me spend a bunch of time looking over that. But what I love doing is talking with people. I love meeting with people and having meetings and having conversations and talking on the phone, talking on Zoom. I love listening and talking with people. So I fill up my schedule with those things because I think it's more of what I'm good at, what my gifts are. And we have other people that are more data centric and they fill their schedule up with data and doing those things. And they're both equally high payoff, but we use our gifts and what motivates us and what's important to us. And when your entire organization is using their gifts and filling their time with the highest payoff activities to them, then you have an organization full of people that are operating in their gifts, in what they're good at, in what motivates them, and the entire organization is going to improve in that. So again, we have to have the freedom to say, I know what I'm good at, and the humility to say, I know what I'm not good at. And then find people who are really good at those things and delegate those things to them. Let them do those things. Let them operate within the gifts that they have. And you operate within the gifts you have and schedule it out. Schedule out those activities. So how can you know if your activities are producing the highest ROI? You have to know your destination. And we're about to out of time, so we're about to wrap up. But I want to leave you with this. You must know your destination. Don't go to sleep tonight after this call and jump and not know where you're going. What are your goals for your organization? What are your goals for you personally, in your career, in your family, in your physical life, in your mental life, spiritually, all these things? What are your real goals? What do you want to do? What impact do you want to make? Write those things down. And if it's not a goal list yet, just have a dream list. Start with your dreams. What do you want to do? What motivates you? What excites you? And if you don't know those things, how can we say we're being productive? Because we don't know that we're making progress towards anything. So we have a beginning place of where we are. We have to have an end place of where we want to go so that the steps that we take are getting us towards a destination so that we can be productive. And one of my favorite quotes as well is, if you don't know where you are going, any road will get you there. So you can feel like you're productive. You can feel like, oh, I'm making so much progress. But if you don't know where you're going, you can take any road and feel like you're being productive, all the while you're not actually getting anything done. So you have to know where you're going, and then you'll be able to identify the road that's going to get you there. And it should be a very specific road that's going to take you where you want to go. And so my final questions are this. So where are you going? Where are you going? What do you actually want to do with your life, with this year, with this week, with the 24 hours you've been giving? Where are you going? Where are you going now? What direction is your life going right now? What direction do you want your life to go in the future? Where do you want to look back 10 years from now and say, oh yeah, I did what I said I was going to do? Where are you going? My next question is, how will you get there? So you have to fill that gap. Where am I? Where am I going? How do I get there? That's this big gap. And that's where these daily productivity tips come in. To master productivity, we have to know where we're going. We have to know exactly the steps it's going to take to get us there. Schedule them out based on their how high payoff they are, and start taking those daily steps every single day. And so the last thing I want to say is, we want to help you get there. And again, like I said at the beginning, I am not some guru or expert or people that put, I'm a thought leader on LinkedIn and all those things. Not true. I am a normal person just like you. And I'm here saying, I want to be more productive, and I hope you do too. However, I'm blessed to work with an organization that has a process that helps a normal individual like myself be incredibly productive. We want you to have that process in your hands as well. We have people in over 90 countries around the world. We have materials in over 30 languages around the world, programs in print, programs online. You can do online classes, and you can meet from your home office. You can meet in person. We have all these different options, all to help you be more productive. And again, you will not find an LMI person that works in our organization that thinks it's all about themselves and we have all the answers. We don't have all the answers. We're here to help you find the answers for your life. And we're here to use our time-tested process to help you find answers on how you can be more productive, how you can lead yourself better, how you can lead others better, and then how you can eventually change the world once you've drawn a circle around yourself and changed everything inside of it. We at LMI deeply desire to help you get there and partner with you in your success journey. So what we've been doing since 1966, and we really hope we can do it with you. So if you're on this call today, or you are watching the recording and you feel motivated, like you want to take that next step, would you just reach out to us and let us know? We have a thing called the total leader concept, like I talked about at the beginning. We start with personal productivity, manage your time, then you lead yourself through personal leadership, then you lead others through motivational leadership, and then you lead an organization through strategic leadership. No matter where you think you are on that, we all need to go back to that personal productivity step first. If you have not taken that step yet, I'm asking that you would take that. Take that first step. Take that first step and see what can happen. Try us. Try us. And we would love to partner with you in success. I am a testament to the success of the LMI process. When I joined this organization, I had no idea what I was doing. Now I feel way more organized. There's still a lot of room to go. There's a lot of progress that still needs to be made. But when I look at where I was when I joined this organization to where I am now in my personal life and in where I want to go, I can honestly say that it has made an incredible impact on me. And all I'm saying, whether you choose to use us or not, is I want that same impact on you. And all I know is the tool that impacted me and the tool that's impacted our people around the world, over 2 million people. And so I'm asking that you would do that as well. Take that first step and try us out and see how it goes and see if you're more productive and if you can focus more on high payoff activities. It takes a lot of time to develop bad productivity habits, and it takes even more time to develop good ones and override those bad ones. This webinar is not going to fix your productivity. You can even try to implement what we talked about today, and it's not going to happen. It's not going to take a day. It's probably going to look more like a year, 2, 3 years. It's going to take years and years and years of implementing these things on a daily and weekly basis to override these bad habits and develop good habits. And that's why we want to partner with you on this long-term process. It's not about reading another book, listening to another podcast, attending another webinar like this. It's about beginning your success journey with time-tested things that get you real results, that are things you can implement in your life on a day-to-day basis. So I hope that you'll do that. And if you are interested in that, would you email us at info@lmi-inc.com, or you can message me personally on LinkedIn. Again, my name is Jonah Erb, and I'm the president here at A Leadership Management International. And even if you don't use us, I just love meeting people. So would you let me know that you watched this or you were on the call? And I would just love to have a conversation with you, hear what you're doing, hear what excites you, hear what motivates you. It's a blessing to me to hear that from you. So I hope you all have just an amazing and blessed day. I hope it's successful in all areas of your life, professionally and personally. And I hope that this was helpful to you. And I hope you have a something you can work with now to kind of lay the groundwork and the foundation so you can build the house, build the life that you want to build for you, for your family, for your organization, and for your community around you. And I look forward to hearing from you. And I look forward to partnering with you. And I know our LMI family globally looks forward to partnering with you as well. Have a great day. And we'll hopefully talk soon. Thank you, everyone.